Hi, this is Eric Brustowski, and welcome to another segment of EP on EP. I'm delighted today to have Dr. Andrea Natale with me, a longtime friend and a great guy and leader in our field. Andrea has many titles. I asked him which one I should use today. So we're going to go with Executive Medical Director of the Texas Cardiac Arrhythmia Institute. Thanks for joining us, Andrea.
Thank you, Eric.
So the topic today is your approach to persistent AFib ablation. And what I'd like you to walk us through is sort of, first of all, how you got there, because it is a very unique approach. And tell us a little bit about the study and what you do when you're in the lab.
So obviously, as anybody else, we started with a pulmonary vein. And then very early on, we sort of realized by using imaging, at that time in the early 2000s, was intracardiac echo, that the pulmonary vein really are just, at least what the people that those day thought was the tube of the pulmonary vein and the ostium are just part of the venous structure, and there is a posterior extension. Obviously, embryology support that concept. And at the same time, we saw that by doing what those day we call it the ostial isolation, and then challenging patient with high-dose of isoproterenol, we saw a lot of firing from more proximal region. So that's how sort of very quickly the pulmonary vein approach evolved to what we start calling the antral. It was, our group was the first one to sort of use that term, mostly to differentiate what people were doing with the ostial isolation. And then, you know, the antral became sort of mainstream, but our antral really has always included the entire posterior wall. For the most part, because it's embryologically is coming from the same tissue from which the pulmonary vein come from.
Can you stop you a second on that? So just technically then, what do you do? Do you first isolate the veins? Do you do them two by two? Yeah. And then hit the wall in between? What do you actually do?
So that's a good question, because this is another thing that we sort of try to address in different ways. So the way that most of the people do is to make this big circle around the vein. We kind of realize that by doing that, the same concept can be extended to the posterior wall. If you do a box of a discrete circle, one or two lesions that are that are not effective open the entire area. So what we sort of realized that by using the approach that we call the roving lasso, where we move the lasso in different segments and end up with a sort of a scatter plot or lesion, is less likely to be associated with the reconnection. So in fact, for many, many years, although, you know, if you look at the literature, many centers, they reported 90% reconnection rate. Our reconnection rate in redo cases was in the order of 10%, so much less. And I think part of that is this sort of roving lasso approach, where we end up with multiple lesions in the same area. The lasso, the circular mapping cutter is a very floppy cutter, so conform better to all the sort of the recesses of the left atrium. So I think we get better recording and a much larger amount of lesion in the same area, with a lower risk of reconnection of the same area.
So we've taken care of then the veins in that posterior area, which you consider kind of, in a sense, a structure, right?
Yes.
So then, but I've sent you some patients and I've read your reports. You go on to do other things, yeah. And tell me how that evolved. I know sometimes you'll do the appendage, sometimes you'll do the CS. How do you figure that out when you're once you're done with the first part?
Yeah, it's been an evolution. So one key, and when I talk to people, I say, you know, this is our approach. Don't necessarily do what we do, but at least follow your patient, because a part of what we learn is by following the patient long term and realizing what works, what doesn't work, and what different things we need to do. So the fact that we early on have very little pulmonary vein reconnection sort of draw attention to what else can we do to address this patient. Whereas people that always see reconnection, they keep sort of doing the same things and kind of delay the maybe moving to different areas. So what in those patients, they would come back with pulmonary vein isolation and posterior wall isolation. We really spend time in looking at what else can be responsible for this by being more aggressive with the high dose isoproterenol approach, and kind of extending the ablation to area that don't necessarily result in reinitiation of sustained arrhythmia, but even non-sustained, like skipping beats, mm-hmm. extrasystole that are frequent enough, or maybe short run of tachycardia. So we start becoming more aggressive with the non-PV trigger approach. And you know, we realize that, you know, coronary sinus, appendage, those are the area that once you are done with the posterior wall and the pulmonary vein, become more relevant. We always do the superior vena cava on the right. This is something we do in the first procedure.
That's standard.
The standard, yes.
Is CTI standard also?
CTI we don't, you know, and this is kind of something that is still very popular because I think electrophysiologists know how to do it, so they feel that they're doing something that they are
And if I remember correctly, maybe correct me if I'm wrong, didn't your group publish a paper years ago saying if you actually got rid of the AFib, you didn't have to worry? Wasn't that your group that published that?
Actually, we were the first to publish that, and now there are several randomized studies showing the same things, that the flutter is just a manifestation of fibrillatory syndrome.
So if you have a clinical flutter, you might do it.
If I have it in the lab, I do it. If the patient is documented flutter and also fib, usually we really do the standard PVI. We don't spend time. But if the patient either goes in fib and an organizing typical flutter, we do it to stop it, but really not with the intention of, you know, achieving.
So probably, at least for me, the most controversial part of your procedure is this left atrial appendage isolation. So talk to us a little bit about that, because it's got consequences, right? I mean, there are potential stroke consequences. So is that routine or is that selected patient by patient?
No, it's not routine at all. I mean, the first time we actually try to avoid it if we can, but we do everything else. So we do the coronary sinus, the posterior wall, depending on what we see. The only group where we are more aggressive are specific group where we've seen that if we don't do that, so we have enough experience to say in this group, if I don't do this, it's gonna come back. People that have, for example, severe left atrial scarring, hypertrophic cardiomyopathy with large atrium, people with history of cardiac surgery, especially mitral valve surgery. There are certain subgroup where we do this preemptively the first time. Also, with knowing, realizing that both the appendage and the coronary sinus can require two procedures the first time you address them. So if it's not like the pulmonary vein where we got to a point where it's very rare that people need another procedure for the pulmonary vein. For the appendage, because of the way we have to do it to avoid complication, it really takes a couple of procedures in about almost half of the patient. Same is true for the coronary sinus.
So that's not routine. You'll make that judgment call.
Yes, when you're at the time of the procedure.
At the time of the procedure, what you see, something like that. If someone was a fairly high stroke risk anyway, would you tend not to do it because you might be affecting that, or is that not part of it?
No, the stroke risk is kind of a controversial issue. To be honest, I mean, we do TE in this patient at 6 and 12 months, and we never saw a clot like other centers reported, but we are very aggressive in advising patients not to stop the platelet, and we tell them, you know, even if a doctor tell you to stop it, you call our center and we give you a protocol so that you can do it safely. And we never really have seen what the European described. So I think part of that is not good advice to the patient. So patient go home, and we've seen this at the beginning. At the beginning, the reason why we have been more aggressive is because we've seen people that go home, they see a cardiologist, say, well, you're in sinus rhythm, well, you're taking the blood thinner, stop it. Mm-hmm. And so we are really very aggressive in explaining this to the patient before the procedure. And so probably because I think some of what the Europeans have seen is because they sort of do it and they don't really explain to the patient what that means.
So if you stay on the anticoagulants and the stroke risk,
you're fine,
down.
Yes. But when you stop the blood thinner for, and sometimes people have to stop, I mean, this is life.
Colonoscopy,
so,
things
yeah,
like that.
Colonoscopy. So when you stop the blood thinner, we have patients that have a thromboembolic event even in 48 hours. So we really tell these people, and we haven't figured it out who's gonna be okay. We have patients that stop it with really bad flow velocity and they have nothing. And the patient that stop it in 48 hours, they got trouble. And we haven't figured it out who's gonna get in trouble fast, who's gonna get in trouble, who's not. So we tell people, try not to stop it. If you have to stop it, we want to bridge you with Lovenox until 12 hours for whatever procedure. And then in 24 hours, you're back on the Brattina.
So it's an interesting thing too, because you probably know one of my things is that people need to get away from this concept you have to be an AFib to get a thrombus and an embolism. You know, there is this theory that and that's why they don't they say, well, if you didn't have a AFib within 30 days of your TIA or CVA, then it probably wasn't related. But what you're just saying is a very good point for people to remember, that when you have a dysfunctional atrium or a scarred atrium, it may be thrombogenic even in sinus rhythm. Yes. And that's a very important point you're making there. Yes. I think that people have to remember that.
Consider, you know, once you have the appendage, mechanically is not contracting, so it's almost like in atrial fibrillation, even if the patient is in sinus.
Andrea, that was a wonderful discussion on your general approach to persistent atrial fibrillation. So I thank you very much for that. And we're going to do another part where we're going to go, what do you do next?